can I take your order?
What do you want?
Tangerine Fanta, please.
Tangerine Fanta, please.
We do not have that.
They do not have that.
Tab, it's fine.
Just a tab, then?
No.
Nope.
Pepsi Lime?
Pepsi Lime?
We have Coke.
They have Coke?
Newer Classic.
Is it Newer Classic?
Just regular Coke.
Do you have any milk water, like a Yoo-Hoo?
We don't have that.
Anything from the Slice family?
Don't have it.
Anything from the Welch's family?
No.
Do you have anything that has any kind of Baja Blast in it, whether it be Mountain Dew, Pepsi, anything?
I guess no, sir.
Let's take a water then.
TBTL.
Guess what day it is? Guess what day it is?
It's Friday, Friday. Gonna get down on Friday.
Everybody's looking forward to the weekend.
Well, that should take care of those two evil geniuses for a while. I hope that they've learned their lessons that computers are built by people, for people, to help people, not to control us.
Before we go any further, I need to know if there are any hidden recording devices in the room. I will find out if there are.
Yeah, I'm sure you would, but there's none, because that would be stupid of us, and we're not stupid.
Silly move.
It's a no.
Watch out for that first step. It's a doozy.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to a very special Friday edition of TBTL. This is, of course, the show that's too beautiful to live.
Just another manic meatball.
This is the final episode, not of TBTL ever. Luke is fine. I should choose my words more carefully when hosting this show. This is the last TBTL of 2023. I'm glad to be spending it with you guys. By the way, my name is Andrew Walsh.
My motto is to catch a snake, become a snake. Think like a snake and be a snake.
Luke is traveling today, so I'm helming this ship along with a special guest whom I will introduce in just a moment. We have actually tons of things to talk about today. I've had this mental and then eventually physical list of things I want to talk about with our guest host today. One of them, by the way, is related to bowling etiquette. I went bowling last night with some friends, and what the people next to us were doing left us aghast.
Oh, won't somebody please think of the children?
Aghast. I'm telling you, if you think you do not have an opinion on this matter, you will, even if you've never been in a bowling alley in your life. I believe I can bring you around to feel outrage. Or our guest will bring me around to stop being such a petty jerk. We'll find out. Also, we will do some special Friday Blurs Days, which I guess we're calling Flurs Days. No, that's where that ends. We'll do that in just a second. I'm also remembering that I have not prepared the Blurs Day segment, so we will be doing that on the fly. That's going to be a real adventure. And that adventure we will do with our dear, dear friend. I believe you know her well.
What's your name?
Fletch.
Full name?
Fletch. F. Fletch.
That's right. It is Phyllis P. Fletch Fletcher. Phyllis, thank you for being here.
Oh, thanks for having me. I'm excited to be here.
Got through the intro.
Hey, it was
I told
great.
You I might have to stop down at some point, restart if I make any huge mistakes. That's the hardest part, just getting through that shit.
You know, you nailed it.
Thank
I saw
you.
The whole thing. It was beautifully done. And thank you for making this awesome coffee I'm about to
oh,
enjoy.
Yeah.
I'm going to do something to make it possible for me to enjoy it. It's gross, but I've been saving this for you.
Wait, what?
Watch
you brought
this.
Something?
Watch this.
Oh, you're pulling out, what are you pulling out? You're pulling out a tooth guard of some sort.
Invisalign.
Oh, is that what that is? I didn't know what, I thought for a second you had one of those little flossing pick things.
Right.
And you were doing that because I've said I'm not a big fan of those.
Oh.
But then you put it in your mouth and all of a sudden your mouth split into two and I didn't know what I was seeing.
Aaron, now I'm going to do it with my lowers. Now okay, that you know what you're watching.
Now that I know what I'm
listening
looking forward to.
Listen to this.
Well, happy New Year, everybody. I love
disgusting.
That you're saving that for the broadcast.
I had to.
Thank you. Now you can drink that coffee out of that WMMS mug.
It's so awful that I... So, props to anyone who's ever done Invisalign. As soon as I got it, I took a picture of myself and sent it to Luke, because I know he has this same tooth gap, front gap thing that I have.
I thought it was a tooth whitening thing.
Oh, no. It's like braces.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
And so, I don't hate my front gap like he hates his. They are not... I made sure, like, do not correct... So-called correct that.
Yeah.
Do not close that.
They're both cute, actually. Oh, I don't think I knew that Luke didn't like his. He talked about
how he doesn't like it.
It gives you character, though. It gives
Thank
one
you.
Character, I feel
yes.
like. Yes, yeah.
Thank you.
Sure.
But I have a problem in the back, so it's not even cosmetic that I'm doing. Like, I'm not going to look super amazing when I'm done with this, but it's supposed to prevent... This is what I've learned about our teeth, Andrew. As we age, our front teeth can crowd together, and our back teeth can run away from each other.
Really?
And when they run away from each other enough, they can create, like, pockets, and you can have problems from that.
Uh-huh.
And so my dentist warned me, like, maybe 9 months ago, you know, at some point I'm going to either recommend a crown or Invisalign, and I hate having my teeth drilled into, so I'm begrudgingly doing Invisalign.
For how long now?
My first allotment of trays is 7 months. So I'm really only like a month into it.
You're a month in.
I already hate it so much.
Does it hurt?
Only on the first day of new trays, which this is.
Mm.
So this morning I was like crabby about that. It's like uncomfortable and feels like pressure, but after when it's almost time to change the trays, and even really just after a few days, like it doesn't bother you as much, and you change every 2 weeks. But the thing that's bunk about it, actually, the other thing I'm gonna do while I'm on the show here is set my timer so that I know how long it's been out, because it's only supposed to be out a couple hours a day. And then, like, that's how I realize, oh yeah, I can't just sit around drinking Diet Coke anymore. I can't just have pieces of Toblerone whenever I want them. I can't go to the vending machine and get peanut M&M's when I want to. So
maybe
you know.
That's the secret agenda of the dentist, right?
Well,
he wants to protect your teeth.
I know. Well, and then that's the other thing too, is before you put the shit back in, you have to brush and floss.
Sure, yeah.
So
yeah,
I do
sense.
That, and unless I'm drinking, you know, some kind of like, you know, if I'm just drinking like a Diet Coke or a coffee or something, I'll just brush. Mm-hmm. I won't floss, because that seems like overkill. With all the other flossing I'm doing, it seems like overkill. If I'm eating anything, or even, you know, even if it's like a soup or something, like I'll floss and brush and put the shit back in. And it's like, ugh. So I do probably have the cleanest teeth I've ever had, and probably healthiest gums, but I'm like, I can't wait till this is over.
Yeah, no kidding. You got to brush those things too, right?
Or how do you keep them clean? The aligners?
Yeah.
The insides of them you brush, the outsides you just rinse,
okay.
Because when you brush, you're putting like little micro like scratches in them almost over time. And even though you only have each set for 2 weeks, he was like, only brush the inside. The outside surface you want to keep as smooth as possible.
For strength of the tray?
I guess for that, and also, why else? I don't know. There was some reason that he was like, you don't want to scratch up the outside, just the inside.
Maybe he's reusing them.
Okay.
Do you think that's the issue? Like, no, you don't want to scratch the outside. Just bring those puppies back to me. Don't worry about it. Throw them in the bucket with the others.
Dr. Huang would never. Oh my God, Dr. Huang, I love him so much. So he bought the practice from my old dentist. And something he said made me think of, I was in a dental office. It made me think of the Outside Bones song.
Oh,
Kim
yeah,
Schmidt,
sure.
You know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I was like, well, they are Outside Bones. And he was like, haha. And I was like, you know that song from Kimmy Schmidt? He was like, what are you talking about?
Yeah. I feel like Kimmy Schmidt references, especially like references to specific moments in Kimmy Schmidt, like not universal.
But he's a dentist. I was like, someone must have said this before me.
The Outside Bones song. Yeah, Titus's song. Yeah, let's see if we can find that here. Maybe I can just play it at the end of the show if you can remind me of that. Let's see here. Outside.
So
yeah, I don't know how to spell on the fly. I have a dentist appointment tomorrow for the first time in a long time. I am usually pretty good about going to the dentist.
Mm-hmm. 5, 6, 7, 8. Trident gum is as chewy as gum. Give it to your friends and chew it with your teeth. Your teeth are bones that live outside. They hang from your lips like bats. Oh, outside bones, outside bones. Never forget your teeth, outside bones. They bones that you wash, and when you're a kid, they fall from your head. And to make things less weird, we say they got stolen by a demon that your parents know.
I love that he calls the tooth fairy a demon that your parents know. Do you want me to send you this so you can send it to Dr. Wong?
I did send it to him. I was like, I'll send it to you. And then I really did. And then when he wrote back, this cracks me up because it's exactly the kind of thing that Luke would like scrutinize probably for hours on end. He wrote back, haha, thanks. And I can't remember what the punctuation was, but I was like, oh no. And I was like, first of all, is that really him? Second of all, does he think I'm really nuts now?
How did you send it?
I emailed it.
To just like the main, like, do you have his like direct email?
It's an email address for the business that I later learned he actually does check.
Okay.
Because he helped me when I had a dental emergency this summer with due to my like teeth running away from each other problem that he warned me about. So I know he actually reads it. But then the next time I came in, I was like, I can't remember if I brought it up or if he did, but somehow it came up and he was like, that song, it's really true. They really are like outside bones.
So he did. He did stick to him.
And I said, they hang from your lips like bats. Like, what else needs to be said? He was like, yeah, it's true.
It would be so funny if we started. Do you use my chart for any of your like medical needs?
Yeah, but not for dentistry.
No, not dentistry. But it would be funny if we just start using my chart to send our doctors memes and whatnot, ma'am. This is my chart. Right. Please respect the my chart.
Or just, haha, thanks.
Yeah. Thanks. We got another one. Oh, God. We got another one. Actually, speaking, I was going to say we could send Far Side jokes to our medical providers. But that reminds me of something that I was telling you before the show. I'll try to tell a shorter version here, if you can believe it. But I had mentioned on the show a couple of times that I thought it would be fun. I got recently a Far Side page a day calendar that is like, you know, a compendium of old Far Side jokes going back to the, I think, early 80s when Gary Larson started writing those. And I thought it'd be funny if, like, the original idea was like I would read one a day, like, okay, it's Monday, this is the Far Side joke of the day. And then we thought, oh, maybe it'd be funnier if we had, like, if I send them out to people and people called them in and we played them off the voicemail line or something. When I mentioned that, I've heard from like a handful of people who are like, hey, let me be one of those Far Side readers. I'd love to do that. I'm like, all right, this idea is really cooking now. Also, Luke's gone next week, so if I started doing this, like, he can't tell me no. You want to tell me no? Get to work, buddy. Right. Come on in. We're all here. So I'm like, okay. So I start taking photos of the first week of cartoons, the first five cartoons that would be the Monday through Friday of next week. The first one is a joke about eating dog that I still don't understand. There's one about lynching. And there's one that makes fun of blind people for protesting outside the wrong building. Great. And I'll tell you what. I don't think I need to bring that in the TBTL universe right now. Like, are you like, three out of five? And not even, like, somewhere in the dog days of summer, as
right,
it were.
Right. But just right out the gate.
Just January 1st. Oh, well, this is a cartoon about eating dog meat. Right. So
the calendar wants you to know who it is.
when a calendar tells you who it is, right, believe them first time.
That's right. Believe them on January 1st. Yeah.
So anyway, we will not be doing that bit anymore, which is a bummer because I actually had started producing and I started taking photos of the. It was literally one of those things where I'm taking a photo of day one. I'm like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
And then day three, I'm like, oh, God, really? And day five, I'm like, who assembled this goddamn thing? Are you kidding me? So anyway, sorry to be a bummer, everybody. I don't know. Maybe we can do it with Marmaduke cartoons. I can't remember what the publication was, but somebody back in the late 90s, some satirical magazine or something, took a bunch of Marmaduke cartoons and then just changed the caption to every single one of, oh, Marmaduke, you big dumb dog. And it worked.
It works every time.
Oh, look, he's sitting on lasagna or sitting on an apple pie. At least half of those are him sleeping somewhere he's not supposed to be. And he's so big and so dumb.
In high school, I would go to my boyfriend Lamar's house and he would get the Sunday paper out and he would open up to the comics like very hurriedly, and he'd open it up to Family Circus and he'd like start doing like a slow like guffaw to himself, and by the end he'd be going, "That Billy," and he'd be reaching for the scissors. He cut it out and put it on the fridge every week.
I thought he was being sarcastic at first.
You can't tell.
I think I like Lamar. What's he up to?
He's around, man.
Can he host with me next Friday?
No, he probably could.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Okay, I have a question for you here. What is up with shipping at 24hservice.vip?
I don't know. I do not know. Oh my God. It seems like such a scam. And then in my case, it wasn't.
What is going on? So I don't even remember mentioning this on this show. I know I talked a lot about it on Spotless, but I quasi impulse bought a like sort of a kitchen sink sponge holder thing, as you do. It's like it was one of those, you know, like real Instagrammy ads that showed how cool this thing is. It stretches out, it fits any sink, but it's like kind of bright colored, and it actually fit a need I really needed in my house because I'm having issues with my current sponge holder and the goddamn suction cups that won't work. So I'm like, wow, you know, this thing keeps on being advertised to me. I actually need this functionality. It's cute. I never buy things directly off of Instagram. I usually, on the occasion that I see something, I usually will like go look for it somewhere else or go directly to a company's website and buy the product there. But this time I was like, oh, come on, the youth are doing this. Like, don't overthink this. Just buy the stupid thing. I know it's going to be a little bit too expensive. I was bummed, like, the shipping was expensive. It was like $18, and the shipping, like, kind of, you know, it was maybe like $8 or something. And then the tax was way too much. It was like almost 50% sales tax. I'm like, this is bullshit. But like, it's like, okay, now I've paid like $36 for this thing. I felt a little bit foolish, felt a little bit chagrined. I didn't want to tell Genevieve, like, I spent $36 on this stupid sink rack thing. How am I going to explain this? Not that I'm going to be in trouble, but it did seem a little overpriced. And then I'm like, it's probably going to come and it's going to be like a piece of junk anyway. We'll see. So anyway, the irony, and I don't know if you heard this follow-up. Maybe this is why I was talking about it on the show. I thought it was funny. While I'm going through this sort of mental and emotional turmoil over feeling a bit like a dingus, Genevieve was by the sink a couple of weeks ago and said, "Hey, you know, this thing isn't sticking to the sink anymore. I saw something on Instagram that sort of telescopes and fits on any sink." And I was like, oh my God, I love you. I'm like, it's supposedly already on the way. Did I already tell that whole story on this podcast?
You said that then the shipping showed it was somewhere weird. That was what you got up to.
Ireland. Yes.
Yes.
And so all of this. So then I'm feeling a little bit better. I'm like, okay, well, Genevieve actually wants this thing. So I paid, I don't know what you'd pay. If Bed Bath & Beyond still existed, I don't know what you'd pay for this thing. Not $36, but okay. So maybe I overpaid by $15 or whatever. Like, let's stop agonizing over this. I just sort of felt like a dupe. But anyway, so I'm like, oh, well, Genevieve wants it too. We'll see what we see. But I was confused as to why. I mean, clearly this thing is coming from the depths of China somewhere. Like on my PayPal statement, I think there's literally Chinese writing or something.
Wow.
Or like the company. Like, you know, this is, I'm sure, made by a very well cared for and well paid staff somewhere, workforce somewhere on the other side of the world, right?
Yes.
But I never got like a notification that it was shipping from China. I got a notification from, and I didn't notice this at the time, but the email address was shipping@24hservice.vip.
Yeah.
And it said, hey, your order's on the way. It's just clearing customs, or it arrived at customs in Ireland or something. I'm like, Ireland? That's weird. So I'm like, I don't know what's going on with that. But then I continue to get updates. Like every few days, I get another email from shipping at 24-hour service or 24H service, right? And it's like, all right, it's cleared customs, and then nothing for a few days. And then it'll be like, okay, it's on the move again. It's giving me like these little updates. And after I told that on the show, this must have been a couple of weeks ago now, and I still do not have this thing. I'll skip to the end there. But you texted me and you said, by the way, I'm still waiting on something that I ordered forever ago and it's not showed up. And I'm getting emails from something called shipping@24hservice.vip.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, that sounds like something else. Like, what? I'll go check my emails. And I check my emails. I'm like, son of a biscuit.
And I was even more rude. I was like, I think that thing you did was a scam.
Yeah, you were like, oh, this is clearly a scam because you said you had done some Googling around, right?
And that was exactly it. I like when I got my shipping notifications and they just looked really weird and were coming from like Vienna or something. I was like,
you were getting it from
Wait
Vienna.
Just a goddamn minute. These are cat paw socks. Like, there's no reason for them to be coming from that far away. And I was like, well,
wait, why are we buying cat paw socks?
My friend, there's three people in her household, and it was a pack of three socks, and they just got cats this year, and they love their cats.
Okay.
And I was like, well, even if they don't fit each person, like, maybe all three will fit one person or something, but they make your feet look like a cat paw, okay. You know? And I was like, that's pretty funny. It's cute.
And so
and
you're having
a total Instagram impulse by, like, they show people putting on the socks, and then their feet are moving around like it looks really fun. I was like, that's so cute. Oh, my God. Click. Ah, what did I just do?
And so you're having those shipped to you or directly to your friends?
To my friend.
Okay,
and
so you put in their address. Okay.
And her name is Kristen, so it was like, dear Kristen, you know, it's blah, blah, blah. And I was like, oh, no. Like, you know, and of course, I never said anything to her about them coming. So I was like, all right, I only have to be embarrassed, like, to myself if these never show up. But dang it. And so, like, it looks sus. It was weird. I was like, let me look and see what this domain name is that's sending me these emails, because now I can't even find the Instagram ad anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And it was that 24hservice.vip.
Sorry, shipping at 24hservice.vip.
I was like, this is bunk ass. And so I Googled it, and sure enough, I was like, scam, one star, scam, scam, scam. I was like, no, I just totally fell for an Instagram scam. And then, like, so I kept getting, and they were like, yeah, those emails you get are to delay your claim.
So that if you have to, that's what Genevieve was saying. Because yeah. I got my latest update on this, I think, yesterday, or let's see, just a couple of days ago.
And what'd it say?
And so what it does is, so it gives you in text the update, but then you can also click a button to track your parcel, which I've been doing.
Yep.
And I've been wondering after you sent that text, I'm like, well, what is the scam here? Aside from them taking my money, like, am I downloading malware every time I go to this website or something? Which I'm pretty careful about that. I'm not downloading anything, right? But it does say, dear Andrew Walsh, your order number, I'm not going to give out the order number now for privacy purposes.
All right. In case your bogus-ass order gets hacked.
But this is what I love. And the product name is, and then in parentheses, emoji of a gift box, 2023 Christmas hot sale, emoji of a gift box, end parentheses, updated telescopic sink storage rack, smiley face yellow. And then it says your tracking number is this, but it gives you a long tracking number, but it's not for like USPS or UPS or FedEx. Mm-mm. It's whatever they're using.
Yep.
24H service, right?
Yeah.
We check that your package logistics status has been updated. Okay. It is now in transit. That's the latest one I got. Okay. Now, if I hit the button that says track your parcel, I see that I've gotten about 10 of these updates, starting with back in the very earliest of this month. It was in Ireland, and then it left the sorting center. Mm-hmm. Then it was in transit in Ireland, arrived at the customs of Ireland, left customs, then shipped to the United States, arrived at customs of the United States, declared customs clearance of the U.S., arrived shipping partner facility in the U.S. And then the latest one is departed shipping partner facility. So I'm assuming they have some on the ground shipping partner. But, you know, I still haven't had it. And this whole time I'm thinking, like, well, Phyllis has Googled this web or not even the web address, the email address. And it looks like it's a scam. I did some Googling. I saw a bunch of warnings about it as well. But I'm like, but what is the scam now? Like, why don't you just stop sending me emails and stop reminding me of it?
Stop remembering that.
Stop remembering that, because that seems like a better scam. But Genevieve said what you said, like, maybe they're stringing you along so that if you ever file like a claim with PayPal, which would be my only recourse here, I think, or if a credit card company, if you did it that way, that like it's so long in the past that they've just strung you along. Is that your theory too?
I think I read that theory. I don't think I came up with it, but it made sense. And I was just like, ugh! And I marked my calendar to like, I wanted to wait to like the day after Christmas to be like, well, they didn't come in time and blah, blah,
because it was a gift. Yeah.
But they showed up.
They showed up at your friend's house.
Yep, they showed up at my friend's house. They got a notification that it showed up. I got it like after I had gone to bed. I got like a notification that it showed up. And so I, the next morning, emailed or I messaged my friend and I was like, did you get a package? And she was like, oh, we didn't check the mail yesterday. Let me go take a look. And then she had one and she opened it up and she was like, it's cat socks. Are they from you? And
I
was
like,
oh, yes. And I was like, oh, I'm so glad they showed up. And I just didn't go into the whole thing.
That's always the awkward moment, too, when especially you've been on this journey.
Yes.
So you've been tracking it. But your friend doesn't know that.
No.
So they're just like, you have to be very careful with that phone call, right? Like, because you really want to check to make sure it showed up.
Yeah.
But you also want to be like, so, you going to thank me? Like, did you get anything special lately, Kristen? Anything you'd like to tell me? So anyway, you did not feel awkward making that phone call?
No. I mean, we DM each other. We're in like a group chat together.
Okay.
And we're constantly talking to each other. So I just DM'd her and was like, hey, did you get something? And then I was hugely relieved that it actually was them. And so this is because of how she said, like, we didn't check the mail. I bet it was in her mailbox, which means that maybe their partner, their shipping partner, might be the postal service.
That's a good
so
point.
So do you have informed delivery?
I do, yeah.
So you could check that and see if maybe something's on the way. It doesn't, not everything always shows up there,
mm-hmm.
but maybe it's on the way.
I think I saw that today and it did not say that anything is expected
okay.
this week, but we'll see. But
yeah.
the fact that you got yours, so I am very confused about like what we're reading online about this being a scam. Like
right.
I went to one website that sort of ranked various businesses or something about trustability,
uh-huh.
and it gave this email address,
really?
24H, whatever, a 68%.
Huh.
And I was like, I literally don't know what to do with that.
Yeah.
That's really interesting. First of all, it makes me trust the website, because I'm like, that doesn't seem like, it seems like it would either be 100 or zero.
Right,
right,
right, right.
Either they take your money and run,
right.
or it's legit. But
right.
it's like 68%. Like, I don't know, 68% of the time it works every time.
Right, right, exactly. Yeah, well, I mean, you know, I guess if we voted in there, maybe we'd be bumping it up a little bit once your thing comes, which now I'm optimistic.
I'm pretty optimistic,
think it's gonna
too.
Come.
Yeah.
So I'm doing a total 180 on my, like, that's a scam.
Yeah.
Because it worked out for me. But
it was quite the journey for me, though. From going from just, like, just feeling stupid for buying this thing.
Sure.
And then I come in, scam. Right. And then feeling like, oh, I'm wasting Genevieve's hard-earned money.
Aww.
And then I'm like, okay, no, it's good. And then you're like, that's a scam. Like, oh, I'm an idiot again.
Well, but here's the thing, though. You've seen these bunk-ass, rudimentary-looking emails they send. They would be really easy to fake. So
mm-hmm.
maybe the 32% is people who have been scammed by something
That's
else.
True.
And then the thing that they are spoofing is the email, like, to make it look like it comes from this thing.
Because it's just interesting. It's like nobody opts in to do business with shipping at 24hservice.vip. I want to make it very clear. That is not the company that is listed on the PayPal statement,
right.
the credit card statement,
no.
On any of the receipts that I've received. It's like, it just seemed like, okay, well, they outsource this to some sort of like shipping concern or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So I was a little confused, like, why are people claiming the shipping concern is the scam here?
Because it ends up being the only receipt you have.
Yeah, that is true. And it also, it does put some distance between yourself and the original seller, I guess, right?
Yeah.
So, all right. I want to talk to you about bowling etiquette.
Yes.
And I want to talk to you about some things I learned about the very colorful names of various splits in bowling.
Oh.
Do you know that a bunch of them have names?
Oh, you know, I only, I don't remember what any of them are, but I saw some of those things up on like a video display the last time I went bowling.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. They might have had the same system, like
maybe.
Underneath the, like the digital scoring thing on the television.
Mm-hmm.
They were flashing all these little bits of trivia, some bowling related, some not.
Yeah.
And some of that trivia were the names of various splits you can get.
Yep.
In bowling,
yep.
including Little Murphy.
I don't know about
Little
Murphy.
I can't wait to tell you about Little Murphy.
I'm excited.
I was so excited. I was more excited when I bowled a Little Murphy last night than a strike. So anyway, I also bowled more Little Murphys than strikes, I think. But anyway, we'll get into all that in just a second.
Thank you, baby.
Phyllis, it's very rare that I have somebody in the studio with me when I'm recording the show. Have you noticed a little? Now I'm self-conscious of it because I do it by myself all the time. Have you noticed me wiggling my little button over here?
I saw you were like tapping two of the buttons above those those first two faders?
Yeah, on my board. So I have two, if you can picture, like kind of an audio board, and I have one fader for my microphone and one fader for yours.
Yeah.
And above them are little mute buttons. And so I always mute our microphones while we start a segment or whatever, but then I have to unmute it. But when I unmute it, my button's a little like hanky.
Okay,
it's like a dust in there or something. Uh-huh. And so then sometimes you'll hear Luke say, hey, you sound crackly or something like that. And so I have to like, I have to do this thing where I unmute it. And I've done it 1,000 times in my life at this point. I then have to just sort of gently just sort of wiggle it around a little bit.
Okay.
So if you're wondering what I'm doing, wiggling my buttons, that's it.
I saw that and I wasn't sure if that was the mute button or the solo.
Yeah, that's the mute button. So there you go. Anyway, got that out of the way. Just the listeners were curious.
Uh-huh.
Let's take a moment here to thank the people who make this kind of scintillating conversation possible and audio boards like this possible in all reality, like Stephanie Gundell of Seattle, Washington, supporting the show today, along with Maria Thompson of Alexandria, Minnesota.
Nice.
You thought I was going to say Virginia.
I really wasn't sure where you were going with that.
Yeah, we're zigging. You're zagging. Try to keep up, Phyllis.
Yeah.
Natasha Bruzowitz of Moses Lake, Washington. Mm. If I'm mispronouncing anybody's name here, I hope you know that I apologize. I'm doing my best. One of these days we'll get pronouncers. Science is not there yet. There's no way to get pronouncers for people's names.
No.
So someday, though. Catherine McFadden of Portland, Oregon. Now, Catherine, I've met several times. Catherine and her sister, longtime listeners of TBTL and supporters. Mm-hmm. Thank you both. Angie Dominguez.
What?
Austin, Texas. Friend of mine, Angie, congratulations on the new pooch. And thank you for supporting this nonsense. Always a little shy to see friends' names there. And Lindsay Mavallo of Carrollton, Texas. Carrollton, Texas.
Oh, I've been to Carrollton. I know where that
really?
Is.
Really?
Yeah, it's a suburb of Dallas.
They're using all the R's and all the L's.
They are. I know.
That's a lot.
It's true. It's a lot.
Double R and a double L.
Yep, I remember.
Followed by a ton.
Yeah.
Carlton seems like a lot, right? But I guess it's like that's Texas, right? Like everything's sort of bigger
that's
in Texas.
True.
It's like, oh, yeah, no. If you can use a double of either one of these things, let's do it. But that was probably not Lindsay's decision. Either way, I support it, and I thank you all for supporting TBTL for realsies.
Hello, and welcome to Top Story.
Well, you've been begging me to talk about bowling etiquette all show, so I guess we'll take a moment to get into this. I've mentioned the show. In fact, this reminds me, I really got to get myself some bowling shoes, my own bowling
shoes.
Oh,
yeah, right.
Me and my friend Nikki, and sometimes with Genevieve, have been going up lately to go bowling at Linwood Bowl and Skate. I've talked about that on the show a little bit. Now, Linwood Bowl and Skate's been around forever, and when you rent your shoes there, they're very old and gross, sort of. And I'm not trying to, I don't want to bash on Linwood Bowl and Skate. I want that place. I want people to go there and spend money, and I want that place to stay open. They're doing what they can. The staff there is wonderful.
Yep.
But I will say that I've never wanted to buy my own bowling shoes before. I was slipping my feet into these things from like 1972.
And they probably don't have that many choices at your size, right?
Yeah, like, that's right.
You have some big dogs there.
Who was...
Those are huge.
Who was making fun of my feet the other day? Somebody said, "Oh, I was at a friend's." You know, I don't love going to shoes off houses, right? But
yeah,
I went to my friend's. I went to my friend's house, a shoes off house for Christmas,
okay.
And so Vives and I went over there, and so you know, of course, I take my shoes off, and they're down by the door, and then
I wonder if I know whose house this is.
Yeah, I don't have a problem saying it was Camaro, Kevin, Anita.
Oh, okay, I didn't know they were shoes off. Okay.
Yeah, and Anita's Croatian, and they're very generous. They she makes. Why am I blanking on what it's called now? But it's basically the cabbage rolls with meat inside.
Oh, delicious.
It takes like 24 hours to cook it.
Wow.
It starts with an S, and I'm blanking on what it's called.
I don't even know.
Anyway, it's really good. Served with like a side, like a big fist of meat served with a side of kielbasa and potatoes. And like literally like it's something that I think it takes them like 2 days or like a full day to make, basically.
Wow.
You start it the day before.
Fist of meat.
A fist of meat, of spiced meat wrapped in cabbage. If you like
delicious.
It, you like it.
I would love it.
Oh,
that sounds great.
It's so good.
I'm going to be starting to angle for an invite. Come on, man.
It's driving me crazy. It's a very simple name. It's like, it's not, Well, whatever. I'm going to ruin the show if I get hung up on that. But anyway, so we've done that a couple of years in a row now. And it's nice, you know, we don't have family living around here. So we go over there and Kevin and Anita are there. And Anita's mom is visiting from Croatia. And then Kevin's parents come over. So it's like a whole like family thing. And so it's the whatever that is, seven or eight of us. And then I think it's Kevin's dad is like leaving. All of a sudden, he's like, "Whose shoes are those? You got what are those skis? You got skis down there?"
He's roasting.
Yeah, and he's like, "You're like, what? You must not be able to find shoes." I'm like, "I do okay, Dale. Like, don't let's not worry about."
Did he get
about...
in the shoe and get a giant like paddle and start rowing home?
He did. He did. Which honestly, his funeral there, like, those are pretty old shoes, but just before the break, I mentioned that there's little bits of trivia on the TV screens at the bowling alley.
Yeah.
And one of the bits of trivia is that your foot is the same length as your forearm.
I've heard this before.
And I'm looking at that, and I'm sitting there with my friend Nikki, and she's like, she's a nurse, so she knows about the body. And we both look at each other, and we're like, that's bullshit. Like, that, there's no way that's right. And then we immediately do what you think.
Okay, yeah.
And we bring our forearm down to our shoe, and we're both like, son of a gun.
Did it
that's
work?
Pretty close.
Oh my God.
It's pretty,
now
do you
want to
do it?
Yeah.
No, everybody. I hope people are listening on the bus right
I'm
now.
Do it. Okay.
I was listening to the radio the other day and somebody did something like this.
Yeah.
And I'm in my, it was more of a vocal thing. They're like, boy, if you say this, it sounds like this. And then I'm in my car doing it. And the host was like, now everybody is in their car doing that. I'm like, man, you got me. You see me. How are
okay,
you?
Okay. I got to back up a little bit.
Okay.
So
yeah. Go ahead. No problem.
Over.
No problem. I'll continue with this story in the meantime. So how's it looking though? Pretty close?
Dead on.
You're pretty flexible too, by the way. I'm really impressed with that.
Thank you.
Wow. So there's a little
pretty
trivia
cool.
for you right
yeah.
there. Yeah. Yeah.
That's amazing. I love it.
Now, do you know that if your hand is bigger than your face, you're an idiot?
I know this one.
I tried that at Nikki yesterday, too. She also did not fall for that. As an old kid, so the kid puts their hand in front of their face and you push it into their face. Anyway,
so
where was I? So anyway, so we usually go to Linwood Bowl and Skate, and this time we went to a different bowling alley called Spin Alley in Shoreline, which is a first of all, really clean bowling space. Most of the bowling alleys around here are so old and don't have like the money to do full upgrades. And especially a place like Linwood Bowl and Skate, like there's a whole, you know, skating element to it. It's huge. Like the upkeep of a place like that, especially any kind of major renovations, must be pretty daunting. And so I was really impressed with the Spin Alley and how clean it is. But it's a much smaller place.
Okay.
And some of the layout down by the bowling the actual lanes is like really kind of not set up perfectly. Like it's really hard to find a ball. Like you have to crawl over all these other families that are bowling. And like, it's just sort of set up weird with these permanent tables that don't suit conversation well while you're bowling. So I had some notes that I am going to be emailing into the bowling alley later, but I was impressed with the fact that the shoes seemed like kind of newer and cleaner. Everything just seemed a little bit newer and cleaner.
Okay.
Ended up being a problem for me though, because the shoes, like the heel of the shoe, you know, it's still rubber. It slides a bit, but it's rubber. This was newer rubber. And the first ball I rolled, I got stuck on the lane and tripped, and actually I accidentally stepped into the lane because I'm used to a certain amount of slide in the old grungy shoes up at Linwood. So I go to bowl and I like kind of stop short and sort of fell into the lane.
Yikes.
I had the worst game of my life.
Oh.
First three frames I bowled a four and a three, which I don't know if you're good at math, but that's trending in the wrong direction. You know, like a four and a five. There's hope,
right.
You know.
Yeah.
But anyway, it is really cramped, and then I kind of get used to the shoes, and there's like a family bowling next to us. And by the way, it was hard to find, it was so crowded in there that there were not a lot of extra bowling balls, and I have like big feet, I got big ass hands, and so I need the balls with the really big holes, and I simply could not find any.
And you probably need the holes to be a little bit farther apart.
If
from
they
each
can
other.
Fit in there, it's fine.
Okay,
you know, but I could not find a ball that my fingers fit in, and so I went to the young woman at the front desk who was just like working her ass off. I mean, it was so crowded for a Wednesday night or a Thursday night. It was so crowded.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if the holidays maybe had something to do with that as well, or it's just a hot spot. Like, I'm glad. I want to reiterate, like, I'm so glad these bowling alleys are busy because I do not want them to close and I want options.
Yeah.
But I went up to the young woman. I'm like, hey, if we're paying by the person as well as the lane, can I just return my shoes and I'll just watch my friends bowl because I you don't have any balls that fit my hand. She's like, oh, they got to be around somewhere. Did you check here and here? I'm like, I checked everywhere. But it turns out like a lot of people were not returning their bowling balls to like the stand. So like she's like, I'll find one for you. So she like goes and like crawls over all these people like asking, are you using this one? Are you using this one? Until she finds one that fits my hand. Like her service was amazing.
That's
so I'm like, okay, great. So I have the ball that works for me. Nikki and Genevieve get their balls. We're bowling next to this family. Then that first family leaves.
Okay.
And so we don't have anybody next to us for a while. Mm-hmm. We're all the way at the end. We're lane number one, by the way, not to brag.
Nice.
If you want to recreate this at Spin Alley, lane number one, all the way to the left. Uh-huh. So we only had like one area that we had to share. You know how in a bowling alley, two lanes next to each other share the same bowling ball.
Ball return.
Ball return. That's the word I'm looking for. I was going to call it the bowling ball spitter. I think we'll go with ball return.
Right.
You know, you're sharing the place where the ball comes back out. Yeah. And this new, I'm going to call them a family. It's a woman, I'm going to say, I don't know, maybe around my age. It's sort of hard to tell how old she is, but like an adult woman with a, I'm going to say a young man, maybe in his 20s. Mm-hmm. And then a younger person, I'm going to say maybe in their teens or something.
Okay.
It was very unclear for, it was unclear to me like what the relationship between these three people are, but I'm going to say some sort of family structure of some sort, right?
Yeah.
And so they're bowling next to us. Also, by the way, they got big plates of food. They had some sort of like chicken wraps. It looked like the best damn bowling food I'd ever seen. Now, I can't eat at a bowling alley because the whole time I'm just thinking about how gross my hands are at a bowling alley.
Yeah.
But man, the food looked really good there. Might just go back to eat someday. By the way, this one woman, I thought she was going to be really good because she her very first time she bowls a strike.
Damn.
Turns out that was fluky. She wasn't bowling strikes the whole time.
Okay.
But the reason I noticed that was because I'm like, oh, this must be somebody who comes here a lot and like kind of, you know, really knows her way around the bowling alley.
Yeah.
Which made it all the more shocking when Nikki got up to bowl a few frames later and her ball wasn't there. And she's using a very bright orange or bright pink kind of ball. And then we see it come out the return and we realize, oh, this woman is just like, so we're there with our three balls.
Yeah.
This family comes over with their three balls and all of them are just borrowed from the place, right? None of them are things that we brought.
Yeah.
But this woman is now just using whatever ball fits her fingers that are on this shared rack at the ball return. And Nikki is kind of looks at me like, I guess I got to wait for my ball to come back. So it comes back. And now I'm obsessed. And it's not even affecting me because I have this bowling ball that is for my big banana hands, as Camaro Kev calls them.
Yeah.
So like nobody's using my ball anyway. But now I'm noticing this woman and the two younger people she's with, they're just willy-nilly using any ball that comes out of our return. And again, I want to make it clear, like we were there first. We had established our balls. We'd actually the family before us, I think they all returned their balls, like proper bowlers. So it's very clear like which ones were ours. But they're just going up and like it's literally affecting Nikki's game because now Nikki has to wait for the ball to come back and it's not affecting me at all, but I start burning inside. I am obsessed. I can't even have a conversation because I'm just watching this woman and then eventually the two younger people as well just take whatever ball they want. And so then Nikki starts, she's like, I guess we're just doing this. And so she starts taking this woman's blue ball and like she's using that if her orange ball isn't available. And I'm like, are you just rolling with this? She's like, no, I'm irritated as shit. Like this is... And she and I'm just like, I am so mad right now. She's like, me too. Like I, so one thing about bowling etiquette is also you should always wait for the person that's bowling next to you, stranger or not, to bowl their ball before you run up and do it yourself. It's very clear who is there first.
Yep.
Children often don't know this rule.
That's right.
Children should be taught this rule.
Yes. Though.
If you're a teenager, you're old enough to, at what point?
Yeah. I had to be told at some point, I'm sure.
Of course.
Yeah.
I will say that this woman was doing a really good job of respecting that.
Yeah. Okay.
The two younger people she was with, not so much. Okay. But you got to be like, okay, whatever.
Right.
Like, I see that behavior a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Irritates me, but whatever. You work around it. But just, I never, never in my life have I just seen people roll up next to us and just start using our balls.
Yeah, that's weird.
weird? You mean infuriating? You mean boorish?
I find you it mean odd.
Across the line?
Because it's weird that they actually went and got balls, right?
Yeah.
That they brought over, but then they didn't care whether they were using theirs or not.
Exactly.
That's strange.
And just not to have the situational awareness of like, well, we're bowling next to these people, and maybe they're just kind of like a, they do everything family style from dinner to bowling.
Okay.
And it's like, okay, we're all in this together. Like, there's no way they didn't notice. We're talking about very different colored balls here.
Right.
Like,
yeah,
very different. And I would also think that, like, they're different weights. I know, like, I don't know exactly what all the different weights that they were using were, but like, If you're forcing Nikki just to use random balls, well, then is she going from a 12 to a 13 to an 11 or whatever? Like, that's going to affect your game. It's about repetition. Anyway, you're not as upset about this as I need you to be. I need, like, anger here.
I have questions. So Genevieve was there too, right?
Yes.
So what did she do?
Hey, Genevieve, can you hear me? Hey, Vives, are you in earshot? I think I've been yelling in here so much, she's like totally, she's probably got her headphones in.
Her ears became habituated to you saying, hey, Vives.
Wait, I think I hear her. I think she's coming in here. Let's give her a second.
Okay.
Because I'm not exactly sure to what degree this affected Genevieve. Genevieve, we're going to have to share a microphone here. Sorry about the mic noise, everybody. But Phyllis wanted to know what your situation with the ball sharing was last night. Did those boorish people next to us use any of your bowling balls or your bowling ball as well?
I think they did, and at one point, one of them went to pick up the ball that had just was being returned to me because it was my second roll, and I had to say, hey, I'm using that.
Oh!
But I will also note that after a while, I noticed that there was an identical ball to mine, same weight, same color, and that somebody from their party had added to the circulation. So I was a little more forgiving of them taking my ball at that point because I realized they probably just really didn't realize that which one was which. I wasn't 100% sure which one I had put on the circulation or not.
And that was one of the younger people too. So you can sort of chalk that up to maybe being younger and not knowing the rules. I mean, you should be taught that.
The person that I interacted with was a teenager, so he should know. And he was probably bowling the best of anybody in their party also, which I feel like is an indication that this wasn't his first rodeo.
Uh-huh, exactly. Does it – so I'm trying to get Phyllis angrier here. like, as I sat there and just watched this woman willy-nilly pick up Nikki's ball and use it, and then – As soon as her, like, and I was noticing this with the people that were there before them, like, they weren't just using one ball a piece. Like, as soon, they were just kind of grabbing them as they came out. Like, one guy had two balls, apparently, or was using them.
Yeah, so they weren't really.
All right, stern head. Get your head out of the gutter.
They weren't really waiting for their, like, I cannot, unless I'm intentionally like, oh, I like to roll my second half of my frame with a lighter ball or something different. I can't imagine just like randomly picking up a ball. Like I'm pretty intentional about which one I'm rolling with. But yeah, it was just like, okay, this one came out of the chute. I guess this is what I'm rolling with now.
Ridiculous. So rude.
It was a little rude. Like, they weren't unpleasant or anything.
No.
Like, they weren't otherwise rude. So I just think it was, like, a lack of awareness about the etiquette. And I don't mind. I'm happy for them to use a ball that I'm not using, even if it's one that I put up there. But I did not appreciate having it almost taken out of my hands when I was reaching for it.
Yeah.
I the whole time I was really battling with, should I say to this woman, hey, the bright orange ball is my friend Nikki's ball, and so can you not use that one? But like, I was like, why insert myself in this? But Nikki was irritated too.
Mm-hmm. It was irritating. And I was thinking about it as it was unfolding and thinking like, what if, because I saw a guy come to the lockers next to us and pull out his own personal bowling ball.
That it was kind of clear with a bottle of Budweiser in the middle of it. It was awesome.
It was so cool. It was pretty awesome. I told him I liked it.
Yeah.
Like had it been, I think we would have all reacted differently had it been our own personal ball. I would have at that point certainly said like, hi, that's my personal property.
Oh, in a second. In a second. Yeah, my mom had her own bowling ball, not to brag.
Nice.
Yeah,
that's pretty good.
Yeah, not bad. Yeah.
That's awesome.
I always kind of want my own bowling ball. I got to start with my shoes first, though. Yeah.
Start with your shoes. Yeah.
Anyway, is that everything? I guess that's everything. I couldn't remember if you were affected by this behavior and what your level of act, because me and Nikki were pretty hot under the collar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was deliberately trying to be zen about it and just only be angry, not angry, but only let myself feel affected if it was truly affecting me and not just like upsetting my sense of what bowling etiquette should be. And I'm trying to, in general, work on that, like just waiting until something actually affects me before I like fly off the handle about it.
It's a good New Year's mentality going into 2024, because that is my whole thing. Is like I get so in my head about just situational awareness. I sort of put this in that, you know, you'll hear me kind of talk about that a lot in like grocery stores. Like, oh, I'm going to push my cart over here to one side of the aisle. Then I'm going to stand in front of it. So yeah. Me and my cart taking up the entire aisle or whatever. Just like, I just see that everywhere in my life. And of course, that's always, and that's a lot on me, right? Like, I have also people in my life who are so petty, and I see it from the outside. I'm like, that is such ugly behavior. Stop being so petty. But then, of course, I have my shit.
And then Petty Crocker comes out and says, move your cart.
Exactly. Yeah. Real polite bowling ball.
That's right. So. Well, Genevieve left, so I didn't get to say this to her, but part of why I asked what she did is because, like, she seems very reasonable to me, and she also, to me, appears, like, less wary or fearful of confrontation than a lot of people.
She is.
And, like, she'll just say, oh, excuse me, that's my, and then there's no problem, right?
Yeah.
You know, like, so that was, I wanted to, like, find out because, like,
she did say to one kid.
Yeah, she did. And that's exactly what I thought she might do.
Yeah.
And so I was like, and I was thinking about, like, what would I do? Like, probably, I mean, last time I went bowling, it was one of those things where I was with a group that was so big, we were on either side of the ball return, and we just had so many balls there that we were all just like, oh, whatever, okay, you use that one, blah, blah, blah. Like,
and if you're all friends, you know, and you've sort of established it, that's one thing.
Yeah, and before that, I went bowling so long ago. I mean, it was probably when I went with you to Kenmore Lanes. And
wow, that's forever ago.
Yeah, that was years ago. And so, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think, especially because, so I'm a person who, I have a little bit of a problem with my thumb on my right hand, and so I have to use those lighter ones, which aren't always as effective, but, you know,
like
is what I have
really
to do.
Like
an eight,
okay,
you know?
Yeah, I saw that they had some behind the counter that were 5-pounders, I think, for probably mostly young children, but they had a big sign that said only one light ball per lane.
Okay, that's interesting. Yeah. So they must not have enough to just distribute to whomever they want, but I would just probably just wait for another one of those to come around if someone else was using it. But like, yeah, if I felt myself getting pissed, I think I would have to say something. But then it's hard because you're like, okay, but if I say something now I'm already pissed off, so I'm gonna come off like an asshole. So like, that's a tough spot.
Well, I know at one point I definitely said to Nikki, well, we will definitely be talking about bowling etiquette on the show tomorrow. I really did.
Oh my God.
I know. Yeah, no, I'm pretty cool. We do have some blurs days again too, and some music for your weekend, which we didn't even talk about. But I wanted to mention that some of this trivia that we were learning last night. Foot, forearm, same length.
Right.
Interesting.
Yeah, that's pretty
cool.
I
learned that, again, if you went to the same medical school I did, which was Spin Alley in Shoreline, Washington, it said that your stomach must reproduce an entire mucous membrane every 2 weeks. Otherwise, it starts digesting itself.
And is that what an ulcer is?
I don't know, man.
Oh, okay. They didn't.
That's all it said.
You only
I gotta go
took
back
mucus
to my
membranes 101. You didn't get to 102.
Exactly. I got to go back tonight to find out if that's what an ulcer is. And then I also learned some creative names for various splits. Now, I don't know the numbers of pins. Luckily, last night there was a little like diagram that posted right near where we were bowling that I was able to like look at. So, but you often hear people say like a 7-10 split.
And that's the back row, right?
That's the back row. Yep. One all the way to the left, one all the way to the right, right? That's kind of the classic one.
Yep.
And I'd heard that, and I didn't really think about it much. But there's all kinds of different splits you can get. If there's two on one side and one on the other side, or this is the one that got me noticing it, though. Apparently there's and I'm going to probably get these numbers wrong, but I think it's either a 2-7 or a 3-10 split.
Okay.
That means that it's like a pin that is like kind of closer to you on the left-hand side, and then the one all the way in the back left-hand side. So that's either called a baby split or a little Murphy.
Okay.
And I was so excited about calling it a little Murphy. Now, yeah. I've gone online today to double-check that. Uh-huh. I have seen it referred to as a Murphy. Uh-huh. I cannot find anywhere online where anybody else calls it a little Murphy. But I do.
Yeah. Of course.
Spin Alley does, and I do. I call it Little Murphy.
Aww.
And I was so excited every time I got Little Murphy. And then, of course, I would never pick up the spare on that. There's also something called a Greek church, which I think that was two pins on one side. Like, maybe, I won't even try with the numbers. Like, two pins on the back on one side and one on the other. There was one called the Christmas tree or a cocked hat.
Uh-huh.
I believe that's the same one. Okay. There's a million. I'll be honest with you. We're kind of in the middle of the winter games right now.
Yeah.
And I wanted to put together a quiz about this for you, but I ran out of time. And so
I
now
could
I'm
fail each one.
Yeah, I was going to come up with a bunch of fakies, but those were the main ones that stood out. But yeah, Little Murphy, I'm really excited about.
That's cute.
I feel like I should start a restaurant or something called Little Murphy.
Yeah.
It's like a bowling
and integrate that what that split looks like into the logo
all
and
over
the word
the
mark for Little Murphy's.
It would be fun to run a bowling. I mean, I think it would be an incredible amount of work. As I mentioned, I saw these people working their ass off there, and it's a small little family run business, and I met the proprietor, I think, or one of them, and like she was the one who was like bringing food out, wiping tables, like just doing everything, and they were just like running around the whole time. So I don't want to make it sound like it would just be like, you know, everybody dreams of owning a bowling alley someday. But I think it'd be a lot of work, but God, it would just be such a cool atmosphere to be in.
I think also you would do really well on the PA system, and you would educate people about the bowling etiquette.
Oh, I would definitely let people know about bowling etiquette.
Totally.
And I'd probably mention the Little Murphys, too.
You'd program the screens so it
said,
did you know? And then you would have your little
That would be my
lessons.
Trivia.
Yeah.
If you use someone else's ball without asking,
right.
you're boorish.
You're cursed for 7 years.
Yeah. Exactly. There's a right way to rock and a wrong way to roll. You can just listen to your soul. Just remember that life is number one. You can be having so much fun. Just remember that life is much fun. You can be number one. All right, we do have a couple of Blursdays to get to today. Just a couple, though. I think people traditionally hold off on sending in Blursdays during the winter games, but we do have some to share today. And if you want to send some in for next week, I believe Genevieve's going to be joining me on TBTL next Friday, so we'll do more Blursdays then. Or, again, since it's Friday, we're calling them Flursdays today. Only two of these, so you don't have to, like, Luke usually plays sound effects. Do you want, like, a sound effects box or something?
Yes.
Here, let's see. Does this one work?
Yeah.
Okay, that one works, and here's one that makes Halloween-y sounds.
Okay.
I got one over here in my drawer that makes like a, this, let's see here. Yeah, that one. Okay, here, this makes various crowd sounds. I think those are all the sound effect machines that I got.
Yeah,
so anyway,
that's
just pretty
good.
Yeah, I got two Blursdays here. Brandon says, Happy New Year's Eve birthday to Rebecca. I still can't believe we reconnected at a random high school football game 20 years after we were band nerds together. Were you a band nerd?
That's my wife.
Oh, oops, I wanted this one.
Let the fun begin.
Yes, yes.
I thought you were.
Of course I was in the band. Of course.
But what did you play again?
Percussion. Yeah. So in All City, I played snare, and at Garfield High School, I played tenor drum.
Did you ever have the three drums in front of you?
No, tri-toms. I never did, or quads.
I'm not trying to make you feel lesser, but
that would
be really badass.
That's where the badass. I mean, in my day, it was the 80s, so it was the rockers, the guys who had long hair. They played the tries. They were pretty cool guys. Yeah.
Well, this is really sweet, though. So Brandon says that they reconnected with Rebecca 20 years after we were band nerds together. Every minute since has been an absolute joy, from our nature walks to avoiding death traps, the broken car, and two state titles. You're the kindest and most thoughtful person I've ever met, and I can't wait to keep, quote, making memories together in the new year. Perfect.
Yeah.
And and listeners Brett and Amy are wishing our sweet 16-year-old cat, Crazy Smart and Funny Five Rockwell, a happy Blursday. We just played Rockwell's tape on the show like yesterday or the day before. Let's see here. Brett and Amy say, Rockwell has long enjoyed the show, especially when he's contributed his rendition of the Murder She Wrote theme song on piano.
That was amazing.
And his fever dream of a tomato bacon turkey lettuce sandwich recipe for TBTL. That's the tape we played like just the other day.
Sounded delicious.
And there's no telling what he'll get up to on his new guitar and concertina accordion.
Okay.
Nice.
I don't know what that was.
Happy Blursday, Rockwell.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Hope you're all doing well. I know I used to run into Brett from time to time, various places up here in North Seattle.
Oh, fun.
It's nice. Last time, I believe I was leaving a booze store.
Oh.
I'm fine, Brett. Don't worry about me. Let's see here. Before we say goodbye for the week and for the year, Phyllis Fletcher.
Yeah.
It just occurred to me. I didn't pick a listener song to go out with. That's okay. We're just going to play two songs today. One from you.
Okay.
And then we'll go out with one from me. What would you like to start with?
You have to find Emotions by Mariah Carey, MTV Unplugged. Version.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I have it right here.
Okay, cool.
Why are you picking this one?
Well, I can't even remember how I first found it, but when I watched it, I was like, oh my God, she's amazing. Like, I think I'm about the same age she is, but it felt like her music was for, like, you know, kids a little younger than I am. So I wasn't super into her when she came out. But when I watched her perform this in like a live acoustic kind of setup, I was like, oh my God. Like, you know, me late to the news that Mariah Carey is a good singer.
Does she have good pipes?
I mean, so this was another thing I then read about this performance, which I'm like, could this possibly be true? But I guess she says part of the reason she did this, MTV Unplugged, so this is in 1992, because people thought that her, like, whistle register was fake, basically. Oh. They thought that she couldn't really do that.
That it was boosted by technology or something in
something,
the studio trickery.
Yeah, yeah. Mm. She can do it. Like, I never had a question about whether she could, because I know people who can do that. Uh-huh. I know men who can do it as well. But yes, she. if you can play like 90 seconds of this, you'll hear.
Sure, yeah.
She can absolutely do it.
Starting from the beginning, I don't have to drop in anywhere. Yeah. Okay, cool. I don't know that I've ever heard. I mean, I feel like at some point I must have heard this as somebody who just had MTV on a lot back in the day. But it looks like this was released in 1992.
Yes.
So I'm assuming it was recorded around 91, 92.
It was, I think it was recorded in 92 and maybe it was released as an album like shortly after it was
recorded.
Nice,
cool. Well, Emotions is the first track off of this MTV Unplugged, Mariah Carey.
Awesome, man. She's got the whole setup. She's got the backup singers, the pianist, like the string section. Uh-huh. You know how they used to do on Unplugged.
Yeah.
It's awesome. I've watched it so many times.
You see, I'm not watching it here. I'm just listening to it via Spotify. Mm-hmm. This makes me want to kind of see it because I don't think I had much exposure to this.
And she's, you know, in her early 20s then. It's so cool to see her and just to know what became of her. And I actually have her memoir at home, and like watching this again made me like get it back out, and I was like, I gotta read this.
That's pretty cool. Yeah. I've never been a huge Mariah Carey person, but like there is something about that setup of that Unplugged setup that like it is really, really compelling.
So and great.
It's almost like it's kind of the predecessor a little bit. I don't know if you would agree with this, and I don't know if I agree with this, but I'll just say it. A little bit like a predecessor to the Tiny Desk.
It's not
always acoustic, which was sort of what they were trying to do with Unplugged.
Right.
It was literally called Unplugged, but like a smaller, accessible, like we're going to have to like sort of, make this work kind of vibe.
Yeah. Yeah. I was looking up a little bit about the, you know, where they used to record these. It was just some studio in Astoria, Queens. Mm-hmm. It just adds to her mystique for me. And I just thought she was so great. And I was watching something else this morning that maybe I should send in next year as a Christmas song, but it's her singing Oh Holy Night.
Oh.
I was like, I mean, it could have been my Invisalign, but I was like crying watching it. I was like, she's so good. And it was like at just two different parts of her career, but I was like, wow, she really can do this. Like,
I didn't even know that she did Christmas songs.
Oh, come on.
What a great way to end the year. The corniest dad joke. I forgot. I'll just be straight up. I forgot to grab a listener's music for your weekend. I'm sorry. I was so unprepared today. But we'll go out with this actually kind of works out well. I'll play for you a song that I was listening to last night that is good, maybe kind of closing music because there are no lyrics. Boy, did I have a nice night last night. So Genevieve for Christmas got me a record player, a really nice record player with built-in Bluetooth as well, which I didn't even know. Like, I thought it was nice before I realized that.
Yeah.
Then I turned it on and a blue light started flashing in the back. I'm like, are you kidding me? Can I do this? And then Genevieve and I just the other day bought it, like a nice little, Genevieve found like a nice little chest on Instagram. Not a scam.
No, not a scam.
Kind of an antique reseller that Genevieve follows on Instagram. And so we bought this thing to put the record player on, and like in my little dart area down there, it's like it feels like it's all coming together.
Yeah.
And this is the first time I've had like a nice record player. And last night after bowling, you know, having to like kind of like find my center after what I was after my victimization. And so I came in, and I don't have a lot of jazz on vinyl. But we happened to, like, through a dumb White Elephant gift exchange, get this record a couple of weeks ago called, like, The Great Guitars of Jazz or something. It was, like, some compilation. It's really good.
Wow.
Like, I like jazz. I'm not well-versed in jazz. I don't think I'm usually drawn to guitar centric jazz very much, but this was really good, and it makes me want to get more jazz records, which is really an awful thing to say because Genevieve hates jazz so much.
Right?
She calls it one up, one up, bum, up. That's what it all sounds like to Genevieve. But man, when I get into it, and again, not knowing anything about it, but just enjoying it, like it is such a vibe. And so last night on my new little record player, I'm playing darts, listening to this jazz compilation. And one of the artists is Herb Ellis. The song that I liked is, you know, it's a kind of a standard, Have You Met Miss Jones? It was part of a movie that came out in the 30s. And I think it ended up being used in some version of it was in Bridget Jones's Diary as well.
Oh,
I think it's
cute.
One of those songs that had lyrics originally, but this is just like a kind of a jazz version of it. And so it's Herb Ellis on guitar, and it's his album off of Alice in Wonderland.
Oh, cute.
That is the name of the, that's how they really get you.
Yeah.
Those records have such good names.
Yeah.
I love like these cool drug-addled jazz guys in the 1960s just having like fun with wordplay. I love that. So it's Herb Ellis. Alice in Wonderland is the album, and Have You Seen Miss Jones is the song that really, really caught my ear. I sent the whole album to Luke because you know who's on it is, who's his, Oscar Peterson and the Oscar Peterson trio are on this as well. Okay. So I sent the whole thing to Luke and I said, this might be good, you know, airplane music for your flight back from Germany. Mm-hmm. But it turns out that this album would be terrible airplane music. Oh. It's so upbeat and like and kind of noodly. Yeah. But this song, I think, has a pretty good groove to it. So we will go out. We will end the year with Have You Met Miss Jones by Herb Ellis, Oscar Peterson, and the rest. In the meantime, I hope everybody has their... Oh, are you going to do the TBTL sign-off with me today?
Yeah.
Are you prepared to do that?
I would love to.
I always like to ask people that on the air. I always forget what's coming up. But it's been a hell of a year. I hope 2024 is going to be even better. We will be here on Monday with another Winter Games with Luke. I can't remember exactly what we're doing, but it's been a lot of fun doing these shows. So we'll be back on Monday on New Year's Day with that. In the meantime, I hope everybody has a really fun and safe holiday weekend. Happy New Year. Phyllis, thank you for doing this with us.
Oh, thank you for having me. I enjoyed it.
This is a blast. Sorry, yeah. I forgot to say goodbye to you. I'm not what you call good at this hosting thing, but it's been fun. So now we'll do it?
Yes.
Please remember, no mountain too tall.
And good luck to all.
I'm bored. This party is officially boring. I'm bored. And you people are very rude. Let's get out of here.
Power out.